In the last session, we were discussing about a bandwidth of FM waves. As I told, we will take the case with single tone modulating wave where M of T is represented with single frequency signal. Then we went down to deviate in two perspectives, one with narrow band and another with wide band. And narrow band, we called such a case where beta, which refers to a modulation index of FM, which is measured in radians. And we considered the beta to be very, very small value. In fact, a beta less than or equal to 0.3 would give you this approximation to the equality. So we concluded that this is a narrow band FM wave. As I told, this is an approximate representation of FM signal. The striking similarity between this narrow band FM wave with amplitude modulation with respect to their frequency spectrum. We see that there's only an algebraic sign difference between an FM wave, which is generated with the beta much less than one, which was very similar with respect to amplitude modulated wave. Okay, so nevertheless, although mathematically they differ in a very smallest manner, the bandwidth of narrowband FM wave appears to be very similar to an AM wave. So this was one of the part where we had discussed, but this may not be true in all the cases. And we took a case, a general case, where if I take arbitrary value of beta, then we would not get an approximate mathematical expression like in previous case. Now we went on with representing using Euler's rule, and it concluded with an interesting result where S of T, which is a passband FM signal, which is passed through the channel, is given by this particular expression. So today we will pick from this point and try to find out a bandwidth of this wideband signal in general, and that's the last part of this bandwidth session. And I picked this same expression which we had concluded in the last session, where Jn of beta, which is called as nth order Bessel function. In fact, this is nth order of first kind, which is specifically called as nth order of first kind. Okay, mathematically it is equated as 1 over 2 pi integral over the period 2 pi and complex exponential of beta sine x minus nx. In fact, if you try to draw using this mathematical expression, you would arrive at this kind of graph when you try to draw Jn of beta over various values of n across beta. Say for n is equal to 0, so J naught of beta will take this kind of curve, and Jn of beta will take this curve, and so on. Although it appears to be a little complex, in fact, you can draw these kind of waveforms using any mathematical tools. That's not a greatness here, but there are important properties of this Bessel function of first order, which is noteworthy, which is very important for us to take from. Okay, so first property of this nth order Bessel function nth order Jn of beta is that irrespective of value of n, whether it is positive or negative, it gives a symmetry. Say for n is equal to even, it gives an even symmetry. For n is equal to odd, it gives odd symmetry. Okay, so this is one of the properties of Jn of beta that can be observed from these waveforms. Or in fact, if you can substitute particular values of this beta and n, you will get this equality. For small values of modulation index beta, say if beta is much lesser than 1, this is an important property that may be necessary for us, where n 0, for n is equal to 0, J naught of beta is exactly equal to 1 in the sense. So if you can see this J naught of beta curve, it starts its peak from 1. Say for n is equal to 0 itself is this vertical axis. Say J naught of beta is 1. And for J1 of beta, for very, very less value of beta, in the sense beta is very, very close to this this value, J1 of beta is also small, and it appears to be around beta by 2. And for n greater than 2, beta appears to be 0 because n greater than 2, the curves will be exceeding beyond this point. So Jn of beta will be approximately equal to 0. So important conclusion from this second observation is that there are only significant amplitudes of this nth order Bessel function, which are important to us. And finally, there is an equality where the summation running from minus infinity to infinity, the square of all these values at a particular value of beta will give you 1. Okay, so this holds exactly for any arbitrary value of beta. This irrespective of value of beta, this equality holds good. And it's an exact expression. It's not an approximate expression. Okay, it's kind of an area under the curve is unity. Okay, so these are the three important properties or the characteristics of Bessel function, which gives three important observations. So based on these characteristics, we can come with, you know, certain observation which are important to us. So the first observation here is that the spectrum, okay, we need to find out the spectrum here. So the spectrum of Sn of S of t, which needs to be calculated, since you have to convert this S of t, which is in time domain, to frequency domain, the spectrum of FM signal, in fact, this is wideband signal, it can be written as now S of f, which is a Fourier transform of f of S of t, which can be easily see that this is the amplitude and it has only cos function, and we know that cos theta or cos t in Fourier transform, which will be simply a delta function. So I'm using that Fourier property, which is half n running from minus infinity to infinity jn of beta. Okay, so half I have taken out, so this is multiplied with delta of f plus fc and f minus fc. So, but it's not fc here. So, this is fc plus nfm. So, this will have the complete argument plus delta of f minus fc minus nfm. Okay, so this being the Fourier transform of this expression, which will give us the frequency spectrum. It appears that n is running from minus infinity to infinity with the property of Jn of beta. Say in general, for any arbitrary value of beta, you will have a finite amplitude of this spectrum. So, which concludes that there could be infinite delta functions as n runs from minus infinity to infinity. So the frequency spectrum of FM signal, if ever you have to draw, so these are one of the important observation. So that will give you a frequency, say if it is FC, so it will give you all the delta functions. So with amplitudes which corresponds to the nth order Bessel function. So it will have, so these values will have FC plus FM, FC minus FM for n is equal to minus 1. So for n is equal to 2, this will be minus 2 FM. So this will be FC plus 2 FM and so on. So it appears that the bandwidth of FM wave is infinite because these delta functions will run from minus infinity to infinity. So this is absolute difference between your analog modulation with respect to amplitude modulation. Okay, so the spectrum of an FM wave contains a carrier component and an infinite set of side frequencies located symmetrically on either side of FC, which is the center frequency here. So which will have a separation between individual delta values with integral multiples of FM. Okay, so this is the first observation that can be made out of this. The second observation, which is an important observation in the here, is say for beta much smaller compared to unity, or when beta is approximately equal to unity, you can see that From the second observation, for n greater than 2, you will not have any amplitude at all. So for very less beta value or beta comparative to unity, you will have only n is equal to 0 and n is equal to 1 values. So what are the frequency components in such case? So frequency component in such case would be simply, say if this is fc. So frequency component will be, say for n is equal to 0, it is fc. So this is for n is equal to 0, and for n is equal to 1 and n is equal to minus 1, you will have corresponding frequency component as fc plus fm and fc minus fm. Okay, so this is in fact the case for our narrow band FM. Correct. So we have assumed the modulation index of FM signal, which is very close to unity, is a case with respect to narrow band frequency modulation. In such case, you will have only two side bands, which exactly matches with our previous derivation in last session. Okay. So for any arbitrary of beta, it appears that there are infinite number of delta functions, or the bandwidth of FM seems to be infinite. And the third important observation from the property is directly derived from the third property of the Bessel function itself, is that the power of this FM signal, if I were to calculate the power, we know that this is nothing but for say R is equal to 1 ohm, so for 1 ohm resistance, we can write this as RMS value of the voltage squared divided by R. So R, have taken it as 1 ohm. So what is RMS value of this voltage? I mean, what is the voltage value of this modulated signal? This is a delta function which comes with the area under the curve as unity. So AC by 2 summation n is equal to minus infinity to infinity jn times jn of beta is the amplitude of this FM signal. So with that note, we can write the power of FM wave as simply as half AC square, where this is AC by root 2 whole square, which is your RMS value of the voltage, summation n running from minus infinity to infinity jn square of beta. And from the property of a Bessel function, the summation of jn square of beta is 1. So this can be rewritten as half AC square. So the power of the FM wave is constant, irrespective of variations in for various values of beta. The power content in FM is a constant. So this appears from the infinite number of delta functions, that it appears that the power content in FM wave is also infinite, but that is not true with respect to the mathematical relation of nth order Bessel function. We can conclude so. Okay, so but the basic question still is intact, where we need to find out the bandwidth of this FM signal. Still we have not written any expression for it. Okay, so bandwidth, as it is not infinite, as it has got number of side frequencies contained in the band, it is not infinite in extent. So the famous rule, or the theorem kind of statement, is given by Carson. And hence, the statement of the transmission bandwidth of this FM wave is this. So this suffix T is calls for transmission bandwidth. So we can write this bandwidth of FM wave, our transmission bandwidth, sometimes it is written as bandwidth suffix FM, just to distinct between various modulation schemes, as there is from the important property of what you have concluded. So based on the fact that I'll just write on the sideways here. So based on the fact that, say this is one of the observations that is taken from the nth order Bessel function itself, the jn of beta decreases with increasing in n. Okay, so as we know that from the graph, it keeps on decreasing. The amplitude of Jn of beta keeps on decreasing as n value increases. Okay, so with this observation, we can also see that the value of Jn of beta is negligible for any particular value of beta and n. It is negligible for n greater than beta plus 1. Okay, so if you take J3 of beta for n greater than 3 plus 1, in a sense, say if beta, if I take somewhere here as 4, say for n greater than 5, say phi is somewhere here, say for n greater than 5, that particular value of curve keeps on diminishing as it progresses for the increasing order of beta. Okay, so with this important observation, we can conclude that, or we can rewrite this bandwidth to an approximate value or a realizable value as twice of FM supposed to be the bandwidth of a narrow band FM wave, because it has got only distinct delta functions at FC plus FM and FC minus FM, but it is no more 2 times FM, but there are how many sidebands there? The number of significant sideband in these impulses is beta plus 1. This is not any theorem. This is not any, or this is a proof for the theorem. This is just a thumb rule given by Carson that this is one of the closest possible approximation for bandwidth of an FM wave. It is not the number is not infinite here. So this is an approximate value of bandwidth for a wideband FM for any arbitrary value of beta. This can also be rewritten in terms of your modulation index as well. Say we know that delta F is, or in fact beta that we know is defined as delta FM over FM, which is frequency ratio of frequency deviation with respect to the modulating frequency. So this can be rewritten in such way. So delta F by FM, FM gets cancelled here. So you can rewrite this expression as delta F plus FM. In general, we can write the bandwidth of FM wave as twice of delta F plus W. Okay, so this is an important expression for a calculation of bandwidth of FM wave, where W being the bandwidth of message or information signal in general. Say for multi-tone frequency, we can generalize. If there are multiple frequencies contained in the message signal, there will be a frequency, or the maximum frequency contained in that multi-tone frequency will become the W. Okay, this is in case with the single tone frequency. So in general, we can write this expression. Okay, so this also rule gives approximation to narrow band bandwidth. Say for beta less than 1, you say for much lesser than value of unity, you know that when beta is lesser than 1, we can approximate the bandwidth of FM wave is closer to your twice of FM, which is in fact the case with narrow band FM. Okay, so this is an important conclusion made out of this. So this concludes the concept about bandwidth calculation of FM waves. Any question at this point?
Sir, FM is equal to W, sir.
Which one? W, FM is, yes.
FM, W is equal to 2 times FM, since bandwidth of M of T is 2 times FM, right?
No, it's not like that. W is in fact, it's a bandwidth of any message signal in general. Usually this is a notation that is used. So W in fact is equal to FM for single tone. So if there is only single frequency contained in the information signal, you can replace that. Otherwise, if there are multiple frequencies which exist in information signal, you will take the maximum frequency contained in the message signal as the bandwidth or W itself. Okay,
sir.
Because if there are multiple frequencies, it's a bandwidth is nothing but it's a span of or range of frequencies. So you'll have to find out the maximum frequency content in the information signal, and that will become your bandwidth, not the single frequency of any content in the information signal. Is that fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I hope if there are any questions, you can pause here. Otherwise, I'll try to move on to the next part of this first half, which is how to generate and detect FM waves.
Sir, hello.
Yes.
So
yes.
During the power calculation on the right side, here the amplitude is AC by 2, right?
Right. So as we had done in the previous sessions as well. So when I had taken, I think, the properties of angle modulation, you calculate the power. Say power of any signal is nothing but.
So won't it be AC one AC square by 8?
AC square by 8, it will not be because AC, I have taken, I understand your doubt. Okay, you are talking about this factor, right?
Yes, sir.
You are talking about
the AC by 2.
So if you're talking about, yes, if you're talking about that factor, there are two, delta functions as well here, correct? So, one second. Okay, so if that is the case, AC by 2 root 2. In fact, this AC by 2 itself is, we have assumed that to be RMS value itself. Okay, don't worry about that. Even in fact, if you take 2 root 2, it will be, basically my, idea is here that irrespective of value of this, say, I understand your doubt, if I continue with this point, say VRMS is now AC by root 2 the whole square by 2 and summation JN square beta, correct? I hope this was your doubt.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Irrespective of this, I was just concentrating on this summation term. So irrespective of that, the power will remain as constant, whether it is by 2 or by 4 or by 8, whatever it could be. My conclusion from this point is that constant of the power content in FM signal, irrespective of the value of beta or irrespective of, the modulation index itself. Okay, so you can take as AC square by 2 if you are very specific with respect to the power calculation. Otherwise, it is
yes.
fine. Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. All right. So if there are no more doubts, I'll continue with the next part of this chapter, which is generation of FM waves and detection of FM waves, which is opposite of generation. According to the relation of instantaneous frequency and instantaneous angle of an FM wave, we know that in instantaneous angle of or instantaneous frequency of an FM wave is nothing but FC plus KF times M of T, which is in fact we are trying to vary the frequency of the carrier in accordance with the message signal. Okay, so this was the concept with which we started our frequency modulation concept. Okay, so for the design of a frequency modulator, because you need to generate this FM wave, which is called as modulator, we therefore need a device that produces an output signal whose instantaneous frequency is sensitive to variations in the amplitude of an input message signal in a linear manner. The instantaneous frequency should be varied in accordance with the message signal in a linear manner for it to be called as a frequency modulator. There are two basic methods to vary the frequency of the instantaneous frequency in accordance with the message signal. So those two types are called as, one method is called as indirect modulation. method of generating, and with the counterpart of that we have direct method of generation. Okay, so I'll try to quickly cover the indirect part. In fact, that is not included in your syllabus. We have just included the direct method of generation, but nevertheless, you know, it's easy to understand the indirect method of generation here, since I have already talked about indirect method of generation in case of narrow band frequency modulator. I had in fact given the block diagram as well, where you generate the narrow band frequency modulated signal with the simple mathematical expression, where if this is your message signal m of t, and if you have this as your narrow band phase modulator, which will have a sub block of an integrator, and this will so this should be a narrow band frequency modulator, is a complete block. So in within it, it will have narrow band phase modulator with which you can generate a narrow band frequency. And of course, you need a multiplier or the oscillator which will generate the carrier frequency. Okay, so this was the basic setup that we are done. So I'm not drawing anything different. If I go back probably in session 2 or in session 3, if I'm not wrong, we had started with the narrow band frequency generation. Yeah, so this was the block that I had written as indirect method of generation of FM wave. Correct. So this is what I have rewritten right now. I have written an integrator and this complete block in one single block as narrow band FM generator. So first you try to generate narrow band frequency modulated signal using this basic expression of 6, which gives the product and subtraction of two terms. Once you have generated narrow band frequency wave, you need to generate a wide band frequency wave. So wide band frequency wave can be generated easily by implementing another block called as frequency multiplier. Okay, so this will give you in general wide band FM signal. Okay, so the idea behind this indirect method is where, say, the instantaneous frequency of such generated wide band FM signal is in fact was FC plus KF times M of T. With frequency multiplier, it just enhances our integral multiple of the frequency components in the generated output of narrowband FM signal. In fact, this will be an integral multiple of carrier frequency plus NKF times M of T. So what you have achieved with this? So look at this factor, where we know that this is your frequency deviation term. So where we have beta delta F over FM, FM being the message frequency, which is constant, which is not variable with respect to the modulator, which is constant, which is incoming. So we need to vary the frequency deviation term. So for higher values of beta, I need to have higher values of frequency deviation. So this expression, if it's not giving you enough amount of frequency deviation, you should try to enhance it, enhance in terms of multiplying with an integer. So that's what does a frequency multiplier do. So it just increases delta F as required. So that's how you generate a wideband frequency modulated signal. So this is with respect to the indirect method of generation in a block diagram, which we're not going to discuss in detail other than this. So this kind of setup was invented by a scientist called as Armstrong. So in many of the resources, you may also see as Armstrong wideband frequency modulator. So we are not, you know, going to dig deep into this kind of modulator. The second important type, which is, in fact, it is included in your syllabus as well, which is direct generation. And this is used in most of the commercial FM transmitters in case of could be in case of direct FM stations which you receive the signals from. Okay, so this uses an important block which you might have already studied, which is nothing but VCO, so which is voltage control oscillator. Okay, so this varies frequency with respect to the voltage. Okay, that's what we need. We have Fi is equal to Fc plus Kf times M of t. The variable factor is here M of t. So M of t is simply a message signal which varies in amplitude. So if you can vary the direct, if you can directly vary the frequency in accordance with the voltage of the message signal, then we have done the job of frequency modulation. So that's what is the principle behind voltage control oscillator. So this can be implemented in various terms. Probably you might have already studied in your previous semesters where you can include or you can use a simple op amp to do this job. Okay, in its op amp, and in fact you have used op amp as a Schmitt trigger. Okay, so simple Schmitt trigger with an op amp can do a job of voltage control oscillator. Okay, another way of approaching this is this also you have studied with a reverse biased diode, a semiconductor diode. What do you call this kind of a diode? Can anybody tell? Which varies its capacitance with input voltage. You have studied this in the AMC, if I'm not wrong. What do you call such kind of devices? Power actors. So it's a variable capacitor which in connected in series with an inductor. So L and C tank produces oscillations. So that comes with, you know, an important, you know, part here, which is known as two types of oscillator that you have in fact rigged up in your laboratory as well, Hartley or Colpitts oscillator. Okay. Although I have taken a diode as a varactor, so in modern radio frequency integrated circuit designs, you cannot implement diodes which consumes lot of space. Correct. So usually these varactors in modern communication systems are implemented using MOS devices itself. Okay, a simple MOS can act as a variable capacitor when voltage is applied at its one of the ends. Okay, so usually diode is not used, but of course when you have a variable capacitor, you can either use a Hartley kind of configuration or a Colpitts kind of configuration to produce oscillations. So all we need is oscillation controlled by voltage. Okay, so with this we can find out how this mathematically can be expressed or generates oscillation. This simple study that you might have done already. So we can say that the instantaneous frequency, I'll try to take out that 2 pi term when if I use f, so I'll go with the angular frequency. All you need to generate is the instantaneous frequency with unmodulated carrier as omega c, which should be linearly varies with kf times m of t, which is a modulating signal. So where the oscillator here omega naught oscillates with some center frequency. This is your oscillation frequency. As you know, whether it is Hartley or Colpitts, this comes with the term 1 over root LC. Okay, so if you use a certain setup where the capacitance, if the capacitance see here is varied by the modulating signal m of t in this way, say if I take a mathematical expression for this variation as some fixed capacitance varies with m of t. Again, k here is just a proportionality constant. This could be a simple an integer value. Okay, so if C is a fixed capacitance with the values of L and C, and if I try to vary that capacitance, where variation of capacitance will give me oscillations, and this oscillations in fact will vary the frequency of the instantaneous frequency value with respect to m of t. Okay, so if that is setup, then I can use this C into my omega naught as square root of L C naught minus this K times M of T. I'll just replace the term C there. Okay, so this can still be rewritten as, for simplification, say that root L C naught can be taken out. What is left out here? The first term I have taken out C naught, so there is one left here. And what else is left here? Since KM of T exist, C naught doesn't exist, so I have to divide by C naught. Of course, this is under root. Okay, so with this simplification, I can use this as approximately 1 over root L C naught. Now you know this approximation, which can be taken to the numerator as 1 plus K M of T by 2 C naught. So what kind of approximation we have used here?
So this binomial expansion.
Binomial expansion, or your Taylor series expansion of the first order, or this is possible only when KM of T by C naught is much lesser than 1. Okay, so remember this fact, where this approximation is possible only for small value of this factor X. Okay, so either you can apply a Taylor series approximation, call it as Taylor series approximation or binomial approximation, but this gives this value. Okay, so that where I can rewrite this expression now, concisely I can write this expression as omega naught is equal to, I'll call this term the first term, which is a multiplier, as omega C, and what is left is 1 plus K M of T over 2 C naught. Okay, where here omega C is basically 1 over root L C naught. Okay, so this is required for further analysis. Okay, so with that, we can rewrite this as omega naught is equal to omega C. Okay, so omega C gets multiplied on the both the terms here. So I can write this concisely as KF times M of T. So this is actually the desired relation of instantaneous frequency with respect to the variation in the message signal, where I have substituted all the constants. KF here is nothing but k times omega C comes here, and there is a factor in the denominator as 2 C naught. Okay. Okay. So this is the idea behind generating voltage control oscillator, which varies its frequency in accordance with the message signal. Okay, remember we have used, you can use either Hartley or Kolpitz oscillator, where we have taken the Kolpitz oscillator, where capacitance is varied, inductor is fixed, and still you can generate the oscillations in variations with respect to the message signal. Okay, so we can go a step ahead where we have used capacitor here as in the previous stage, C naught minus K M of T. Okay, so as I told, I'll be implementing either a MOS varactor or a diode varactor to vary the capacitor of the tank circuit. What could be the maximum deviation with respect to that? So if I try to calculate that, I just calculate because that of the fact that this may lead to certain distortions in the tank circuit. So if I try to calculate the maximum capacitance deviation, how much I would get? Say the maximum capacitance deviation delta C, the C naught is fixed, so this is a fixed quantity. Okay, so this is the variable value. So what is the maximum deviation that can happen? Anybody tell me? This could be simply K times the maximum could be the peak of the message signal itself. I'll call it as M suffix P. Okay, so message signal can vary in its voltage level to within certain range, and if I pick the maximum amplitude of that variation, I would get maximum capacitance deviation. So this in fact is equivalent, where K I'll rewrite from this expression. Say using this expression, I'll write K as twice of KF times C naught divided by omega C. Okay, and I'll write this delta C over C naught, which is equal to 2 KF MP by omega C. And you know that we have a relation that frequency deviation is defined as KF times what? AM. Okay, so from the definition of the basic definition of your frequency deviation, delta F is nothing but KF times AM, where AM is the maximum amplitude of the message signal. So we have just used another variable as M suffix P here. So I can as good as replace this KF times MP with simply 2 delta F by omega C. Okay, so in practice, what is the reason of expressing this expression will be very evident now. So the ratio between delta F by omega C, I can replace this omega C with FC as well, or I can write with certain constant. So this will be how much? 2 pi FC. So this will be pi FC. So to be very precise, this delta F over FC is a very small value, because the frequency of the carrier will be in terms of megahertz. In practice, the FM stations that we receive of the order of say 80.5 megahertz to say around 108 megahertz. So this is the frequency of the FM station. So this is your carrier frequency. So delta F in most of the countries, including India, we use around 75 kilohertz. So practically speaking, this is a ratio of kilohertz to megahertz. So the ratio is very, very small value. And hence, we can conclude that the capacitance deviation delta C is also very, very small. Okay, so you will not have much deviation with respect to C naught, which is a fixed capacitance. So irrespective of the variations in M of t, whatever may be the variations in the message signal's amplitude, we will not get much deviations in the effective capacitance, and in turn it will give you a relatively stable oscillations. We don't want any harmonics to be involved in the generation of this frequency, because harmonics, as you know, are undesired in case of any systems. Okay. Of course, you can generate this direct FM by using your reactances value also, or the inductance value also. So where the inductance of a coil is varied by a current through a second coil, so you can have a Hartley kind of configuration as well. So this results in a variable inductor instead of variable in capacitor, whose inductance is proportional to the current in the coil itself. Okay, that you might have studied in your implementation in your laboratories. Okay, with that direct FM generation, we can say that it produces sufficient frequency deviation delta F. We need not use any frequency multiplier like your indirect FM wave generation. This gives a decent value of frequency deviation. Also, it gives a good amount of frequency stability. But if you find stability or the frequency stability in this case, you can as well increase the stability by using closed loops. So if you can use feedback kind of a circuit where the output of the loop or the output of the setup, by which I mean, say if this is the oscillator which is giving you a center frequency, say omega naught, with respect to the incoming message signal. Okay, this is the setup of your voltage control oscillator. Say if this omega naught, say if it is not stable, it is not producing a frequency at one value of omega naught, you can implement this kind of a feedback circuit where you can feed this omega naught back into the input and implement a summer or a subtractor. Say this is plus and say if this is a minus, if you subtract this, it will give generate an error. Of course, to convert back voltage to frequency back to voltage, you need another block. Okay, so you need another block which will convert your frequency back to voltage. Say it's a kind of a closed loop block. We'll not talk about this particular block at this point, but this should generate for incoming frequency, it should generate an voltage at the output. The difference between incoming message signal and the error will again loop back into the stable frequency of oscillations. So such setups can be utilized to improve or to enhance the stability of this particular direct generation method. Any doubts?
Sir, why is it subtracted there? Capacitance.
Okay, so that's a good question. I think that should have been asked when I had taken this the C earlier itself. Good that it is coming now. Okay, I'll go back. Yeah, so I had started with C as C naught minus KM of T. That's a good question, where if I had mathematically had taken plus, nothing would have been changed. Only for the fact that it is appearing in the denominator, and when it goes to the numerator, it is just simply an addition. I just wanted to have omega naught is equal to omega c plus kf times m of t. Of course, this would have been minus if I had taken c is naught plus k m of t, but still it would have been varied in accordance with the message signal. Is that fine?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. So that's only just for the since I had projected this will come in the numerator and it will come as positive, I had just taken in advance the negative sign. That's it, to be stated in another manner. Okay, so there is an angle modulated signal with a carrier frequency given as 10 per 5 hertz. So this is 2 pi f. 10 per 5 hertz is the carrier frequency, is described by this equation. This is denoted as phi em, which is another representation of s of t, which is nothing but your fm modulated signal, which is given as 10 cos of omega ct plus 5 sin 3000 t plus 10 sin 2000 pi t. So this is the modulated signal which is given to us, which is angle modulated signal. We need to find out the power of the modulated signal, frequency deviation, and various, you know, factors involved that we have discussed so far. Okay, so to track or to attack this question, we'll try to solve one by one. Say, as the first part, finding the power of the modulated signal. Before, you know, try to find the power of the modulated signal, we need to know an information about the signal bandwidth, okay, which is embedded in modulated signal expression itself. So in order to extract the signal bandwidth, say I can say that the signal bandwidth which is denoted as W in my previous expression. I'll use the same notation. So can anybody tell me what would be the signal bandwidth? This S of t of angle modulated signal in general is written as a cos 2 pi fct with our standard denotation plus kf times m of t. Okay. This is a standard, you know, expression that we have written for modulated signal. So if you compare these two expressions, the second term involves the message signal. Omega ct is a unmodulated carrier. So I need to find out the frequency content in this. There are two frequencies. This is not a single tone modulation. So this is a dual tone modulation. There are two frequencies contained in the message signal. So I need to find out the bandwidth of such signal. So all I need to find is the maximum frequency content in the signal. So what's the maximum frequency content in the signal here? Whether it is 3000 or 2000 pi. Of course, 2000 pi, which is pi is 3.14, correct. 3.14, which is multiple of 2000, will be definitely higher than that. So if I want to find out the bandwidth in terms of hertz, so this is nothing but 2000 pi, which is a maximum frequency content. Okay, so this is in fact maximum frequency content in your message signal divided by 2 pi. This will give me in hertz. Okay, so this is nothing but simply 1 kilohertz or 1000 hertz. Okay, so this is an immediate conclusion or the observation that can be made from the given problem. Rest everything needs to be calculated. Nothing more is given. Okay, so find the power of the modulated signal. The carrier amplitude here is 10 with comparison with respect to my standard modulated signal. So this will give me the power of the modulated signal, which is, I'll take this S as AC as the peak value. So as I told, so this will be AC by root 2 the whole square, for of course for unity ohm of resistance. So this will give me 10 square by 2, which is 50 watts. Okay, so this first part of this question, which is very easy. All right, the second part is calculation of frequency deviation, delta f. Say, in order to find out frequency deviation, delta f, we need to find out the instantaneous frequency. Then only we can find out how far is the frequency is deviated. Okay, we know that in terms of omega, the instantaneous frequency, as I told, we'll be using many a times. It is given as d over dt theta of t. Of course, I have taken omega I here. Okay, this is not W, although this W and frequency and this frequency appears to be same. So this is your simply the frequency, the angular frequency. So here, d by dt theta of t, what is that? So this complete angle, this theta of t, so d by dt of this angle. So I'll write that explicitly. say this d by dt of omega ct plus phi sine 3000 t plus 10 sine 2000 pi t. Okay, so the first order differentiation, this will give me omega c plus what this will give me. So 3000 times phi will give me 15,000. Sorry, so this will give me cos 3000 t plus this will multiply with 2000 pi. So and hence this will be 20,000 pi cos 2000 pi t. Okay, so that's the part with the instantaneous frequency. Now can you tell me what is the instantaneous? Sorry, now can you tell me the frequency deviation? So the fixed carrier is omega c. Whatever is there is your frequency deviation part, right? So the carrier deviation is this part. The carrier deviation is this part. So how can I write? But this has got two sinusoids in it. Okay, so this has got two sinusoids in it. I need to find out the maximum frequency deviation. So for the calculation of maximum frequency deviation, these two terms either add or subtract with variation of t. Okay, so when they add or subtract, at some certain points, definitely they are going to add with an LCM of 3000 and 2000 pi, they are going to add at those points. So I'll take the maximum frequency deviation when they try to add. So the maximum frequency deviation delta F, so this is F max. Okay, see, since I want to have some number, I don't want to keep in terms of variation of t, just to calculate the maximum frequency deviation, I know that this is maximum frequency delta of omega by 2 pi. Okay, so maximum carrier frequency deviation, this can be thought of as how much? So this is nothing but when they try to say at t is equal to 0, for simplest case, I'll get the immediate maximum frequency deviation. So at t is equal to 0, I'll get this as 15,000 plus 20,000 pi over 2 pi. Okay, so we can try to simplify this answer. Probably you'll get approximately equal to around 12,000. Since I have calculated this, I have the answer with me. Okay, so that's the second part. Okay, any questions in the chat window? Okay, good. Somebody is calculating along with me. That's very pleasing. That's very pleasing to see. Okay, I hope everybody is, you know, since I have not asked you to keep any notebook or scientific calculators, it's good to see that. Okay, so the part C, I think, is to calculate the deviation ratio beta. So beta is actually modulation index, or sometimes it is called as deviation ratio. We are done with this. We are doing the part three. Say beta is mathematically written as delta F over FM. So I would have written FM, but since there are two frequency content in it, I would rather write this as W, so that it refers for maximum frequency deviation. Maximum frequency content in the message signal. This we have already calculated, right? So it's nothing but the signal bandwidth itself, which is 1 kilohertz. So straight away I can calculate this 12,387.32 over 1K. Okay, so this will simply 12.39, okay, to be approximate. All right, so the part D is to find the phase deviation delta phi. And you know that the phase deviation is with respect to the angle. And we already know that this theta of t, which we have differentiated already, but the original theta of t comes from this expression, which is omega ct plus phi sine 3000 t plus 10 sine 2000 pi t. Probably from next class, I should have the polling for answering this question. Otherwise, it will be monotonous from my side. So we can have kind of a quiz from the next class. Say 3000 t plus 10 sine 2000 pi t. Okay, so this is theta of t. So with a similar analysis, the maximum angular deviation, delta theta max, which can be calculated. Okay, so I'll give it to you, where for maximum frequency angle deviation is denoted as delta phi, in fact. Okay, so this is phi max. Okay, you can calculate that. I will, you know, leave it with you to calculate the maximum deviation in the angle. The final point, which we did in fact today, is to calculate bandwidth of the FM wave. As I told, this is also called as transmission bandwidth. So this is calculated, this is not infinite, as we have seen today, that this is given by the Carson's rule, which is 2 times delta F plus 1 plus beta. Now we have all the expressions. In fact, we can rewrite this expression as twice of delta F plus. Okay, we can use any of these equations. So we have know the equations in two forms. So we have all the values. We can try to substitute. And can anybody tell the answer, at least for this, for the last part? Any answers on the chat box? Okay, you can cross check with yourself. So this will come out to be around 26.78 approximately kilohertz. To give a feel about application of all these numericals, all these equations with respect to any given condition. Okay, so you'll be given simple modulated wave. All other parameters will be hidden inside it. So you need to extract one or another by comparing with respect to the standard modulated signal expression.